as the choir is coming, we want to look unto the Lord first. Amen. I'm going to wait till they get set up. Let us go before the Lord. Fathers, once again, we come before your presence, dear Father, acknowledging, dear Father, that we can't do nothing without you, dear Father. So we say, dear Father, have your way in your service. Move by your spirit, dear Father. Father, let your word come forth, dear Father. Touch the man of God today that's going to break the bread of life, dear Father. But we welcome you into this service, and we pray that you have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
At this time, we're going to read our scripture, and I'm going to ask that you would stand. Our scripture is going to be coming from Micah, the third chapter and the first verse. Let us begin. And I said, hear now. Amen. You may be seated.
As we approach the throne of grace, we'd ask that all minds focus, all eyes close. All minds focus, all eyes close. Let us pray. Father God, on this morning, we come before you just as we are. Just as we are, just as we are, you are our creator, our provider, you are our savior. We recognize that in the world that we live, that we are being challenged each and every day, assaulted on every front, if you will, challenged in ways that we can't imagine. Which just forces us to rely on you. To rely on you because you are the one true and living God. On this morning, Father God, hear those prayers that are both spoken and unspoken for those who had a mind to be here but were not able to be within the sanctuary. For those who are online that are watching as well, hear their both spoken and unspoken prayers. Father God, here and now we stand on your word. We stand on your word because it is the word of God. The world may tell us different, but your word of God tells us that it's the one truth that we can rely on. So Father God, we recognize that we may slip, we may stumble, we may even fall down, but you are there to pick us up. You are there to dust us off. You are there to carry us through. We rely on you and only you. We recognize that as human beings, they'll let us down, but you will never let us down. Father God, on this morning, hear those prayers. Prayers of the loved ones, prayers of the men and women that are serving both here and abroad. Prayers for our children. Our children, as they grow up in a world that is pulling them different ways, remind the children as well that they should be obedient to their parents and their guardians. Although sometimes they may not understand that, through your spirit, you can convey that to them. So, Father God, on this morning, we ask a special prayer for our pastor and the First Lady. They have returned from a much-deserved vacation. Lift them both up at the prepare and our past prepares to bring the words. This we do pray in your Son, blessed and holy name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. God like Jehovah, and he's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're visiting with us for the very first time. Indeed, you are an honored guest. Any first-time visitors with us this morning? If so, would you acknowledge your presence by please standing? Any first-time visitors? Bless you. Bless you. Yeah! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Three beautiful ladies, thank you. Amen. You may be seated. Bless you. On behalf of our pastor and first lady and congregation of Little Grove Baptist Church, we extend to you a heartfelt welcome to this place. We trust already your heart's been blessed and inspired to worship the true and the living God. And if there's anything we can do to make your stay here, your worship here a little more comfortable, let us know. We'd be glad to. Usher will be giving you a memento about your coming out with us today. Ask you to read it and be blessed by it and come back and see us again. Amen. You've been here several times, but you're not a member. If that's you, would you please stand? You've been here several times, but you're not a member. Anyone. Amen. All right then. Well, Little Grove, you know how we do it. At this time, we show some love to our special guests as well as to one another. God bless you as you meet and greet.
Announcements. for the week of June 28th through July 4th are as follows. Today, there will not be Children's Church. Children's Church will resume on next Sunday, July 5th at 10:30 a.m. On Monday, the Vessels of Praise, My Ministry, practice will be at 6:30 p.m. On Wednesday, noonday prayer at 12 noon, Bible study at 7 p.m. There will also be a budget meeting at 8:30 p.m. immediately following Bible study, and that is on Wednesday. On Thursday, the Divine Praise Choir practice is at 6:30 p.m. On Friday, the Vessels of Praise Mind practice at 6:45. On Saturday, July 4th, on behalf of our pastor in Little Grove Baptist Church, enjoy your 4th of July celebrations. Additionally, sign up today for the annual fishing trip. Sheets are posted on the bulletin board in the hallway outside the sanctuary. Also, Samaritan brothers, all men of Little Grove Baptist Church, please stand, all men. Our 2015 Men's Conference will be held. Amen. It will be held July 10th and 11th. The theme, Who's Bad, Blessed, and Delivered. The cost for both days is $50. There is a sheet in your bulletin board that outlines the whole outline of the events for the 2 days. And that's the information flyer. And the sign-up sheets are posted in the hallway outside the sanctuary, right outside this door to your left, and it's on the left-hand side, the sign-up sheet. Men, on behalf of the Samaritan Brothers President, please sign up today. Have a blessed day.
Good morning. At this time, we would like to recognize our graduates of 2015 and also award our scholarships. Miranda Hill, graduate of Nasmyn River High School with honors. We also have Lauren Smith, graduate of Nasmyn River High School with honors. Kenneth Jackson. Art Institute of Virginia Beach. Ariel Murray and Desiree Walker were not able to be here today, but they were also graduates. At this time, we would like to present our scholarship recipients their letters of acceptance for this year. Lauren Smith. Miranda Hill, Alicia Harley, Bria Williams, Sierra Small, Ariel Murray, and our outreach scholarship goes to Raven Harding. Thank you.
Say amen. It is certainly a joy to be back home. be in the house of the Lord, and in particularly to be here at Little Grove. We certainly are appreciative of prayers, saints, as we were journeying with 6 grandchildren. Amen. Somebody. And we want you to know that your prayers were answered. They had a ball. Amen. Amen. My wife and I are still recovering from the fun. Amen. Father, we are so thankful that you are indeed a gracious and merciful God. Even now, Lord, as we prepare to hear from heaven out of your word, we've got so much to be thankful for. Thank you for allowing us to witness a young man who has committed his life to Christ being baptized today. Thank you, Lord, for the ministry of these young people who have given themselves to honoring and glorifying the name of Jesus. So, Lord, we thank you for them and for all of the persons who work with them. Thank you for parents who are committed to ensuring that their children are brought up in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the kind of commitment that allows the transference of faith from heart to heart and breast to breast as we seek to grow young warriors for the cause of Christ in this church. We thank you, Lord. Now, Lord, we need you. We call upon you to bless us, to prepare us as fertile soil upon which your word is to fall, so that your word will dig deep in our lives and bring forth fruit that pleases you. Lord, have your perfect way. In Jesus' name, amen. Please turn in your Bibles, if you would, to the 3rd chapter of the book of Micah. 3rd chapter in the book of Micah. And I want to use just for a few moments in your hearing this morning the subject, getting out what we put in. Getting out what we put in. I am always amazed when I think about the God of my salvation, who is the creator of all things and sovereign over all things, and who with all of his power and all of his might never forces himself upon us. He'll never make us do anything we don't want to do from the heart. I'm just amazed at the liberty he allows us as human beings to have. We can receive or reject the truth of his word. Now, there are consequences, but he gives us freedom to choose the consequences we want to choose. What do you mean, preacher? God knows that even at our best, we could not, if we wanted to, please him. We would have no desire to please him. And yet God in his wise providence provided for us a way to be able to come to him through his son, Jesus Christ. And yet even though the way has been provided and even though the prevenient work of the Spirit is there, when God speaks to us, he gives us the choice to hear or not hear. So that when the time comes and we have to stand before the Lord, when he asks us to give an account, there will be no excuse for us. Because God has left it in our hands to have as great a relationship with him as we desire to have. And so today I've just come to lift up getting out what we put in. Nothing in. Nothing out. Little in. The children of Israel, both North and Southern Kingdom, have been living life under the covenant relationship that they have with the one true and living God. However, they have been doing their own thing. And rather than serving the God of revelation, they've been serving the God of their imagination. And so Micah comes on the scene, and Micah is contemporary with Isaiah, and there are a few other prophets that he is contemporary with. And Micah comes on the scene, And in this third chapter, he said, "And I said, hear now, O heads of Jacob, and you rulers of the house of Israel, is it not for you to know justice? Those of you who are the political leaders among my people, shouldn't you know what justice looks like? Shouldn't you be prone to exercise justice as my people? Shouldn't justice be foundational in the manner in which you deal with my people? You've experienced my presence. You understand what my standard of righteousness is. You have no excuses. Ought you not to be a people who practice what you know? But the truth is, you hate, you who hate good and love evil." And so the law was saying, the truth of the matter is, you act like you can't stand what's good. And you have an abiding love for what's evil. You who are called by my name hate what is good and love what is evil. You who script the skin
from my people and the flesh from their bones, who also eat the flesh of my people, flay their skin from them, break their bones and chop them in pieces like meat for the pot, like flesh in the cauldron. This is an interesting piece. He says, you have gained leadership among my people. And rather than using the leadership to bless my people, you've used leadership as a way of robbing my people. And you're willing to do anything and everything in order to practice a kind of justice that favors your lusts. He says, you rule not because you have a desire to help people. You rule because your desire is to fill your own coffers. Your desire is to fulfill the lust of your greed. He says, it's to the point you are so consumed by what it is you desire that you flay. In other words, you strip off the skin or outer covering of my people, and you do it through violence. He mentions a cauldron. Cauldron is used to violently, through a state of great distress or unrest, separate meat from bones. He says you enact laws that disadvantage the already disadvantaged for your own good. You do whatever it takes in order to have your way, even when your way is opposite of my word. He could have written it to modern day United States. He could have written it to us. And I ain't talking about to the culture. He could have written it to the church. I'm amazed. All of the response that I've seen and all of the things that folk have said concerning the Supreme Court ruling which happened on Friday. I'm amazed that we seem to be so alarmed when we've been watching it happen all. We've been silently watching all of these things take shape. And then after it happens, we want to get the church has been complicit in this. I'm sort of happy that the world has gotten to the place where they can be so bold, they don't have to hide their agenda anymore. And the reason they don't have to hide their agenda anymore is because they've got folk locally in the state and in the nation that are in position now for them to do whatever it is they want to do. And they've got a president who's willing to go along. So they've positioned themselves and they've managed to shut the mouths of folk in church because they understand that the church has allowed folk who are walking in sin to be leaders in the church. And so they understand that we talk a good talk, but they put their money where their passions are. We talk, but we won't support. They know it. They know it. So they are now able to boldly do whatever it is they want to do. And not a thing you and I can say or do about it, because our mouths have been
So the Lord speaks, not only to Israel, but he speaks to Little Grove. He speaks to the church today. We trying to be so sophisticated and so intelligent that we've forgotten what the Lord has called us to. Hadn't called us to make us happy. He hadn't called us so that we can put his name on our desires and claim that they're from God. He hadn't called us for all of that. He's called us that he might be glorified through us. He's called us so that he could let folks see the kind of rejoicing that takes place when you know you've been redeemed from the consequences of sin. When you get happy enough to thank God in the midst of whatever struggles you go through, that no matter how bad it gets, I know that God has something better for me. Why? Because he's redeemed my. I don't need a new car, a new house, different kind of clothes, a better job to be happy about where I am. I know that over yonder, there is something prepared for me that eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man what he's prepared for me. I don't need things to go my way here in order for me to do what's right in his sight while I'm here. Yet we in church wondering what we can get out of church. God has given you more than you will ever deserve. You will never be able to pay Almighty God back. I don't care how faithful you are in your service. For him having taken your sin and my sin and placed them upon himself on the cross, there is no way we can thank him for shedding his blood and telling us to look to Calvary. And when you look to Calvary with a repentant heart and receive his offer of salvation to us, you can't thank him enough. And yet, what does God see? He sees the church running around upset behind pettiness, putting each other down, talking about each other. Why? Because we want what? It ain't about what God wants. It ain't about what pleases the Lord. It's all about. Study we did some years ago. One of the first things Rick Warren said in the book we studied is, everybody remembers that. First thing he said, it ain't about us. Yeah, bro, Joe, what we do? Who we make it about? Make it about us. It's got to be what we want, how we want, when we want, or it ain't a God. No. Pastor friend and I who meet every Friday is having a conversation Friday. We marveled at how folk will call a person to lead them and then won't follow them after they've called them to lead them. In the United States, we have a tough time wrestling with submitting to leadership that God places over us. So what political leaders know is how to play to the winds that are blowing. See, political leaders have that leeway. They can do that. Now, they don't care about any of your causes, but they'll make you think that if you put them in, they're going to do what they need to do to help your cause But once they get in, the mission is no longer to even mention your cause. The mission now is to stay in that position. Why? Because they know that influence is power. And when you got influence, when you are a brand that folk want to associate with, you will make money because of your influence. Everybody will want to associate with you. These folk got in political position and began to shake the people of God down in order to fulfill the lust that they had for material things and power. And God calls them on it. God says it's not enough that you're in power. You've got to strip the people down to nothingness. And then when trouble comes, look at verse 4. It messed me up when I looked at verse 4. Then they will cry to the Lord, but he will not hear them. I got confused. I thought it was the people being whipped, being messed over, crying to the Lord. No, it was the leaders. When prosperity, Bradon, started being interfered with, they started crying out to the Lord, Lord, help us, bless us. Why? We've gotten used to living in our nice neighborhood, driving our nice cars, having our nice job. We've gotten used to all of the prosperity. Help us, because they associate blessings with prosperity. No. What about all the poor folk in some of these poor nations that God's using mightily? Is he blessing them? Yes. Is he using them to win folk to Christ? Yes. They're being blessed. But they don't have the material stuff we've got in the United States. We've come to understand that we're blessed when we got. Sometimes having robs us of our blessing because we're willing to do any and everything we can in order to keep stuff. Now, don't get me wrong. It's not a sin to have stuff. The sin is when the stuff got. Somebody stay with me. So now times are tight. And they cry out to the Lord. But look at what the Lord says. He will not hear them. He will even hide his face from them at that time because they have been evil in their deed. You see, what did they put in? They put in the idea that evil was good and good evil, rather than practicing the justice that they knew from God. They practiced the kind of justice that favored their own lust. And they were willing to pursue their lust at the expense of others. So now when trouble comes in the midst of their prosperity, who do they cry out to? They cry out to the very Lord that they have ignored while they were reigning over the people. And look at what the Lord says. He will show to them the mercy that they have shown to the people who cried out to them in their prosperity. If you are a person who does not like to show mercy, it's because you have not really experienced his mercy. See, when you experience God's mercy, when you come to understand, you don't dot all the I's and cross all the T's, and you are not who you are because you deserve to be. It's because of the grace and mercy of. We get super agitated with folk who don't dot the I's we dot and cross the T's we cross. We get indignant with folk. I just wish they would
And God says, hold on before you go off. Before you just go off on them, how long have I been patiently waiting on you to do something I've been after you to do for a while? Thank God that he is gracious and merciful toward us. We need to be like the psalmist. Early in the morning will we seek his mercy. Why? Because mercy suits. That's not some of us. That's all of us. So God said, you've been wrong in the manner in which you've treated them. I'm going to let you reap what you've sown. God says, I will hide my face. He says, I'll ignore their cry. He says, I'll hear them, but I won't hear. You ever been in a situation where it feels like everything is falling down around you? And you crying out in the heart of you pray, the worst things get. So sometimes God wants you to do some inventory work. He wants you to stop crying out and do some inventory of how you've responded to him, so that you can understand the need to be sensitive to his presence in your life. Now that's him dealing with the rulers, the civic leaders. The folk who are his ministers, even if they don't know they are his ministers, because every power that is has to come from God. I don't care who you are. The president of the United States is a minister of God. Every senator, every congressman, every state representative, every city employee, every city representative, all of them are ministers of God. And God's going to hold all accountable for how they exercise their ministry while they were serving. I saw a sign saying, love has won out. I just want you to wrestle with this. Because if indeed I got a right to marry Don, y'all hear what I'm saying? I mean, if indeed that's the case, and Josh got a right to marry Lily, I'm just saying, if that's the case. That means that ain't none of us got no real standard that we can point to say that gives us that right. Now, if I want to marry my dog, my cow, if I want to marry me a 12-year-old little girl, little boy, how you gonna tell me I don't have that right? Because ain't no so if I find enough folk willing to go along with me, ought we not to be able to partition our rulers so that we can have the same privileges, since it is constitutional that I have equal rights to do whatever suits my fancy? You see where this is going. And God says, you have allowed this thing to happen. Now he doesn't just deal with the civic folk. look at verse 5. Thus says the Lord concerning the prophets. He's dealing with preachers. Thus says the Lord concerning the prophets who make my people scrape, who chant peace while they chew with their teeth, but who prepare war against him who puts nothing into their mouth. Listen to what he's saying about preachers. He says, you're being complicit in what the rulers have done. You have gone along with their kind of rulership without saying anything, confronting it with the word of God. The church is guilty because we've been busy trying to be accepted by darkness. When the Lord says, how can two walk together unless they be agreed? Light and darkness will never be able to walk hand in hand, because wherever light is, it will expose darkness, and darkness does not want to be exposed. So we the kind of preachers that want to go on all the national shows and talk about, you know, how we ought to view certain things that are an abomination to God in a manner that will not be offensive to the culture, because if we are offensive, folk, instead of coming to the church, will turn from the church. Excuse me. Do you know that the name of Jesus Christ all by itself is an offense to folk in darkness? Do you know that when they get us to shut up about what Jesus has revealed to us, they win? See, there's no neutral. Jesus has already said it. Either you are gathering with me or you are scattering abroad. There is no neutral place. You can't sit on the fence and say, well, you know, I... No. Either you with it or you're against it. And too many of us in the church are against him. Too many preachers are seeking to build a reputation. Paul says to the saints at Philippi, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What was this mind? He made of himself. And yet, what we busy trying to do? Trying to build a reputation. We want to become the brand when the preacher is a bigger brand than Jesus. When it is my brand. So now we've got all of these folk who are doing, Brother Don, what they call finding multiple sources of income. They started out as preachers, but preaching won't just enough. So now they've got to expand into all other kinds of avenues. Now let me say what happens to you. You see what happens to you is when you start raking in millions of dollars. Not everybody, but a lot. When you start raking in millions of dollars, you become an international brand. What do you got to do? You got to do stuff to maintain the brand. You can't come out and talk about controversial issues, because you might lose a whole lot of. So now you limited in how you preach, because your preaching has to embrace the behavior of a whole lot of folk, whether they are in Christ or not. And so the emphasis we put then is on the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit is doing. And the Holy Spirit, this, and the Holy Spirit said, hey, stop talking about me. I'm not the focus of ministry. The Holy Spirit says, I came to bear witness of Jesus. So that when you are not talking about Jesus, when folk not walking away with more of Jesus, then it ain't nothing I've done. When folk talking about they got so high in the spirit and they got so lost in the spirit that the word of God didn't go forth, Holy Spirit say, I won't dare. The reason they got so carried away is because I won't in the house. And folk walk away feeling good and living just like they've always lived and then say, but God is going to bless me. Your deliverance is coming. No, it ain't. Your deliverance ain't coming unless you start walking in obedience to the word of. Listen to what he said. You make my people stray. You are part and parcel of this problem going on because your teaching does not draw people to me. You're chanting peace. And you're doing it all the while you chew with your teeth. In other words, because you are reaping from the rulers, you living a good life. You got something to chew on. So you've joined the rulers in fleecing my people. And you live in the good life. And the folk who not going along with it, look at the text. You are attacking them. You're going after the folk who won't support this foolishness that you're preaching. God had already established how Israel would support his prophets, his ministers. It's already established. God said, you bring to me the tithe. I'm going to take what you bring to me and I'm going to give it to them. But some of them, when things started going south, decided that they would develop their own brand. They would become popular with the masses. Let me say this to you. The Christian message is not a message to share for popularity. If you want to be popular, go somewhere else. I say to preachers all the time, don't get enamored with standing in the pulpit. That's just the tip of the iceberg. Some of that other stuff I deal with that don't none of y'all, well, some of y'all know, but not everybody know. That's the stuff you don't want to have to, you know, deal with. Phone calls you got to make, folks you got to talk to, decisions you got to make. Folk over there don't know why you're making the decision. And you're not at liberty to tell all them folk why you're making decisions about somebody else's life. Because they don't want you telling all the other folk about decisions you've had to make about their life. So you know what they do? When they can't find out, you know what they do? They start talking about you and assuming. I was talking with somebody this week and some stuff we faced, and I was talking with them and they said to me, Pastor, my name been called about some stuff. And I ain't even a member of Little Grove. I said, that's interesting. How your name get called about anything? Because folk don't know, so what they do? What I don't know, I'll do what? You do like I do when I'm in the shower singing. You know, I'm in the shower singing sometimes, and I don't know about y'all, but I sound good in the shower. I mean, I got the tremble in my voice and all that stuff, and the notes bouncing off the wall. I mean, I impress me in the shower. But something happens. I'm singing, and I don't know the next line. But it's sounding good, Brother Don. So what I'll do is I'll do what I call a fill-in. Since I don't know the words, I'll make up some words that sound like they ought to be there, whether they're there or not. Because all I want to do is keep
So some folks say, well, not knowing all the information that they ain't gonna stop me. I'm gonna tell something anyway. So I'm gonna tell it whether I know it or not. And the part I don't know, I'll make up. And I'll make the part that I make up sound as well. But my wife taught me something years ago. Because I used to complain. That thing bothered me. And my wife said to me, on a football field, when the defensive folk out on the field, who do they go after from the offense? The one with the who? Say, if you're going to carry the ball, stop complaining when folk coming after you. You ain't got no reason to complain. God called you to carry the ball. So expect folk. My wife has a way of putting it. That was a good word. I still remember that just like it was yesterday. You know, and you almost hate sometimes when they tell you stuff that, you know, you... But that was right on. So I say to folk, when you get in this position, don't think that everything just gonna be and folk just gonna hug you and love you. Folk will laugh at you in church, smile at you, hug you. It's okay. It ain't you. As long as you're standing on God's truth, and you gotta know you ain't perfect. Some of the stuff they saying true. That maybe you need to tighten up on. But these folk had gotten caught up in their own brand, and they were going along with the political rulers in using the people. So listen to what the Lord says. Therefore, look at verse 6. Therefore, you shall have night without vision. In other words, things gonna get dark, and you're gonna want to hear a word from the Lord, and you ain't gonna be able to. Even when you want to say something, you ain't going to have nothing to say because you will get nothing from me. He says, when that moment comes, you will have night without vision and you shall have darkness without divination. The divine will not be there. I'm going to uncover your desire not to follow me. I'm going to lay you bare naked so that folk will see the fraudulent prophet you are. Don't you get all caught up because folk looking impressive and they got all these folks shouting and carrying on. God ain't impressed with none of that stuff. The Lord knows people. You remember when Jesus was going into Jerusalem and the crowds were out there hollering, Hosanna, Hosanna, and so on and so forth. I mean, it looked fantastic. And Jesus' disciples were going along with them, and they were thinking, we got it going on. I mean, here we going in, and the folk, Hosanna, Hosanna, and going on, and they're shouting, and they're crying, and laying out stuff. It looked good then, till Friday. It looked good on Sunday, didn't it? Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Friday, the same crowd. Behind crooked Pharisees and Sadducees. Crucify him! Crucify him! Why? Because he was not the Messiah of their mind. You all do this, this man's blood is going to be on y'all's hand. Do it. Yeah. Because we have this super desire to have our wills done and God's stamp of approval put on our will. You see, the prophets were guilty of preaching a gospel according to the culture. And they flattered people in their sin. And they showed partiality by loving the people who blessed them with material wealth and attacked people who would not support them in their error. And God says, when the moment comes, I'm going to expose you for the false prophets you are. You're hollering peace when the northern tribe was about to go into captivity. And he says, I'm going to let the people see that what you have been preaching is not true. It is not from me. Verse 7, he says, so the seers shall be ashamed and the diviners abashed. Indeed, they shall all cover their lips, for there is no answer from God. You know when you gotten caught up and you don't know what else to say? Because you know if you say something, it ain't going to be right. So what do you say? I don't know. All of a sudden now, the one who's been doing all the talking ain't got nothing to say. I can say this beyond any shadow of a doubt. When we practice what God's word says, God will surely bless us. I don't know how the blessings are going to come, but I promise you that when life gets tough, when you're walking in obedience with God, he'll give you a peace in the middle of that tough journey that you won't be able to understand. I mean, he'll give you a peace that surpasses all understanding. It didn't say that he won't allow you to go through any tough times. But when you go through the tough times, he promised, I'll be with you. I'll never forsake you. I'll never leave you. I will be with you. And you can go through that tough time. You may not like the tough time, but the fact that God is with you gives you a peace in the midst of it. And instead of squirming and trying to get out, you say, Lord, just bless me to be able to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. It ain't always getting something. Because if he doesn't give us another thing, he's given us more than we ever deserved. I know folk like going to churches where the folk tell you, you know, you give and you give and you give and God gonna bless you with 100-fold and 30-fold. I ain't telling you that. So I ain't giving you no bargain to make you give. If what Jesus has already done for you is not enough for you to give, keep what you got. If your salvation ain't enough, nothing else matters. See, we ought to do what's right because it's right according to him. If he does not respond at all to you doing right, that's okay. Because all you've done is what was. I don't know where we get off on all this stuff where I'm going to give God one, he's going to give me 10. Now, can he bless us 30-fold, 60-fold, 100? Sure he can. But is he obligated to? No! But we can pack the church up. If I start giving you all these prosperity messages where you can live like hell, and God just gonna bless you anyhow, doesn't work that way. I'm sorry, it doesn't work that way. You in the wrong church. Gotta wait till the next pastor comes. And if the Lord say so, I'm going to put him on a 15-year delay. I'm going to try to anyway. That's up to the Lord. I'm just saying. I ain't in no hurry. I ain't feeling no ways. Time. Matter of fact, I think the best years are yet ahead. I feel right good right now. But the Lord says, I'm going to expose this stuff so that calamity that comes upon them will reveal the fact that they did not believe what they were teaching the people. Now, you got to know that the northern tribe was close to being captured by Assyria. They were near that moment. And God was pleading with them to do what was right. It's not that they were not outwardly serving the Lord. They were still offering things in the temple. They were still show up on the Sabbath. But that's all they did. Then they did their other stuff. Just went wild. They continued to worship the little false gods that they'd built in the high place. God says their mouths are going to be shut because they'll have no answer for their situation. Let me close with this so I won't hold you long. Look at verses 8 through 11. But truly, I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord. This is what the prophet says. I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord and of justice and might to declare to Jacob his transgression and to Israel his sin. He says, don't get mad with me. I'm walking in the power of Almighty God by his Spirit. And the Spirit of God calls me, compels me to preach, to confront the sin that is going on. I know folk get all upset and mad, and then they won't talk about me and my imperfections and all that. You ain't got to look long to find no imperfections with me. Matter of fact, if you come to my house, just this evening, come to my house, spend 5 minutes with me, you'll walk away saying, man, if God called that guy to preach. You know, it happens. We human. My perfection is not in me. My perfection is in Jesus Christ. And his truth is his truth, whether it applies to me or anybody else. And so Micah says, God in his Spirit has called me to declare these truths to Israel. And so he says, now hear this, you heads of the house of Jacob and rulers of the house of Israel, who abhor justice and pervert all equity, who build up Zion with bloodshed and Jerusalem with iniquity, her heads judge for a bride. That makes no sense to me. Her heads judge based on the material stuff they receive from who they're exercising judgment on. That's what he's saying. See, your judgment depends on your economic blessings toward me. In other words, justice is not equal. If you come to court and you can't afford no lawyer, you going to jail. You going to jail. But now if you got a little money, sentence is going to be a whole lot different. One boy down in Texas ran over a crowd of folk. I think he killed folk. His lawyer went into court and said, this young man is so rich that he suffers from something. I don't know what he called it, richitis or something. Whatever it was, and actually said it to the judge. Do you know that they gave this 16-year-old kid no time for killing four folk because he was too rich to understand the wrongness of what he'd done? Go to court and tell the judge, I suffer from pruritus. And my pruritus didn't allow me to understand the depth of harm I was doing. The man would tell the folk, dig up the jail, put you in that cell, and put the jail back on top of you and act like you didn't exist. Why? Well, that's the climate we live in. It's not a new thing. So the head judge for a bribe, listen to what it says. Her priests teach for pay, and her prophets divine for money. See, they wanted to go beyond what God had provided. And they were saying, now Joe and them called me, and Joe and them can't get me, but you know what I'm saying. I mean, I got to drive myself to the church, and my armor bearers can't come, and Joe talking about giving me $100 to preach. I done all this work. My brand is big. Now, Lillian called me, and Lillian saying, hey, look, I got 10,000 folk going to show up. I'm going to hook you up. I just want you to come. And they the same day. Joe, I would love to come, but something has come up, and I just can't get there. Schedule me another time, if you would. Why? Because I'm going. Y'all understand what I'm saying? I mean, the preacher is the brand. And folk looking everywhere for ways to make money off the gospel. You hear what I'm saying? And it turns the folk off from supporting the folk who God said ought to live by the gospel. Because we see these lifestyles. And the preachers are as much celebrity as celebrity in our society. There's only one brand in the church. His name is Jesus. Jesus Christ is a brand all by himself. Nobody should be vying to make a name for themselves when they are called to glorify and magnify the name of Jesus. You're not going to get saved because you come to a church where I pastor. You're going to get saved because the message that I preach concerning Jesus Christ is going to so convict you by the power of the Holy Spirit that you're going to receive Christ as your Lord and Savior, and it will be a message from Christ to you, being given to you by the power of God's Spirit, who then will do the prevenient grace work in you to help you to receive that message so that you might be saved. You may forget who was preaching, but you will never forget who saved you. See, we get caught up in names. That's what happened. and folks started chasing money rather than standing on God's truth. I shared with somebody, I understand how it happens. I had the privilege of going back to Liberty University to preach 1 year. And I got to tell y'all, it's intoxicating when you're standing in a gymnasium that's packed with folk. And I was allowed to preach in the smaller gym, 3,500 folk or so in there. And you standing there and 3,500 folk kind of swaying on what you say, how you say it. Oh, it can get intoxicated. And I felt good. Souls were being saved, folk coming. Took us out to dinner, and we ate and had a nice time, and I had to preach that night. It poured down rain, and I said, oh, Lord, I done preached 3,500 folk. I'm going to have 350 folk this time. But when we got back on campus, folk were walking everywhere. I said, where are the folk going? When we got in the gym, it was packed again. And I spoke. And I thought to myself, this can get intoxicating. If you are not rooted and grounded, and Jesus remains the focus of everything you're doing, guess what you'll start preaching to do? Preach to those great crowds. So I see how easy it is for folk to get caught up, and then to get a reputation and a name, so that everywhere they go, masses flock. But when you become the brand, all of a sudden you've got to be able to then speak to everybody in such a way that they won't be offended by what you're saying. So that when you're asked, how do you feel about homosexuality? When you're asked, how do you feel about racism? When you're asked, how do you feel about this or that? You've got to couch your answer in such a way that nobody will be offended. You can't say, the word of God says this, and this is what I stand on. You can't. Because too much money will go missing. Huh? And I might not be able to fly in my $65 million jet. You understand what I'm saying? And the last thing I'm doing is going back to the airport where I got to go with the commoners to get on my plane. It can be intoxicating, and all of a sudden, we become the focus. Jesus Christ is always to be the focus of everything we do. When you give, you can't give looking at me. You got to give looking at him. Your giving ain't a reflection of how you feel about me. Your giving is a reflection of how you really feel about him. Now, you can use me as an excuse, but it won't stand when you stand before him. It's him, not me. And so Micah says, I'm speaking in the power and might of God, the Holy Spirit. My message serves his agenda, not my agenda. And his message to these false prophets and to these rulers, you are serving your own agenda in the power of your flesh, but you're doing it in such a way that you try to make it appear as though you are being moved by the Spirit of God. Therefore, because of you, Zion shall be plowed like a field. Jerusalem shall become heaps of ruins, and the mountain of the temple like the bare hills of the forest. He simply concludes, you're going to get out of the relationship with God what you've invested in your relationship with God. Proverbs chapter 14, verses 31 through 34 says this, and we'll bring it to an end. He who oppresses the poor reproaches his maker, but he who honors him has mercy on the needy. The wicked is banished in his wickedness, but the righteous has a refuge in his death. You may not have a refuge here, but you got a refuge
in your death. Even if you don't receive everything here and you don't want everything here, God's got a place prepared for you so that, when that day comes, you will be, we will be where he is. Listen to what he says. Wisdom rests in the heart of him who has understanding. But what is in the heart of fools is made no. Supreme Court just revealed what's been in the heart of folk walking in darkness that the Bible would call fools, who think that what was done was right because it is popular in the culture, but it is not popular in heaven. And so God just revealed what the attempts were all the time. And one of the things that I love, They never claimed to want equal rights with marriage. They just wanted equal civil rights. But when everybody got in place, they said, hey, let's go for the whole ball of wax. Smart. Righteousness exalts a nation. But sin is a reproach to any people. It's not enough to talk about the Lord. It's not enough to say we love the Lord. It is our actions that speak louder than the words we speak. And my brothers and sisters, I've come to share with you today. God has not called us to talk about, put down, hate folk who've supported this grievous error that is taking place in this nation. God wants us to look at us. Because if we do better what God has called us to do, some of this stuff wouldn't happen. If we were better at what we were doing. See, they've done what they're supposed to do. The question is, are we going to start doing what we are supposed to do? Show the love of God. Show it publicly. Don't tell folk we love the Lord. Let folks see that we truly love the Lord. Stop going in the barbershop and the beauty parlors and talking about all the stuff going on in church. You'd be surprised at how that talk just spreads further and further and further. And all of a sudden, nobody wants to come to church because all the churches are whack. Well, the churches are whack because all of us are whack. We whack folk trying to get right. Instead of repelling or keeping whack folk from the church, we need to let them come. Join us. So that as God does his work in us, he'll be able to do his work in. And then we are a work in progress. But we've got to be willing to take a stand out of our love for the Lord. And when folk talk about you, don't talk about them. They don't know any better. We do. We're walking in light. They're walking in darkness. They don't know their way. We know our way. Jesus is our way. And we need to be able to stand on that. Be confident that God is still in absolute control. Don't go somewhere where folks saying what you want them to say to make you feel better about you. No. Go where you're going to be challenged to be better than you are, because our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ made it possible for all of us to be better than what we are. Remember, we are going to get out only what we put in. Father, we thank you, we praise you, we honor you, we bless your holy and righteous name. You are indeed the sovereign God. And while there is much rejoicing for this rebellious act that has taken place in this nation,
We know, Lord, that it didn't take you by surprise. Now, Lord, help us to be vigilant, to be about our Father's business in such a way that people on the fringes, people who are wavering, don't know which way to turn, will find a refuge in Jesus Christ. Let your peace, which surpasses all understanding, rest, rule, and abide over us, even as we continue to live among people with unclean lips. Have your perfect way, Lord. Every head bowed. Every eye shut, nobody looking around. The most critical moment in our worship experience. You here today, you can't recall a moment, a time in your life when, with a repentant heart, you cried out to the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your life to be your intimate, personal Lord and Savior. Here and don't have absolute assurance that you know that you know that you know that you haven't found. If that's you and you know that if given the choice between heaven and eternal separation from God, you choose heaven. If that's you and you know that heaven is where you want to go, but you don't have absolute assurance, would you just lift your hand up and put it back down? We'll have prayer with you. That today you can receive Christ as your personal Lord and Savior and know, leaving, that you have an intimate personal relationship with Him. Is there one? Let's pray. Father, we thank you and praise you that every person under the sound of my voice claims an intimate personal relationship with the Lord Jesus. Touch us, Lord, that our lives might reflect the profession of faith that we make. If perchance there is someone who will hear this message, does not know Jesus in the pardoning of their sin, Lord, I pray that they will cry out with a heart of repentance. Lord, I acknowledge my sin, and I understand that you died on Calvary's cross, shed your precious blood to pay for my sin. In its entirety. And Lord, I come now offering the blood you shed that the wages of my sin might be paid. I ask you, Lord, to come into my life to be my intimate, personal Lord and Savior. And I thank you for saving my soul. For by faith I believe, because I've asked you, you've done what I've asked you to do. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. I'm going to ask that you would stand just for a moment. Bless you. God be the glory. As CC is coming, I want to share this before she comes. Today is the last Sunday of our calendar year. And we are preparing to go into a new calendar year, July the 1st. And it is my prayer that we will end this calendar year in such a way that the Lord will be honored. Amen. And so I am asking you to give sacrificially, Lord, today to the Lord, that we go into our next year having honored the Lord for all that he's done for us throughout this year. Amen. And I want to share this before I go. Brother Joel, just come to the front so the folk can see you. Come on, you come on down here. Amen. Amen. Bear with me just for a moment. Bear with me for just a moment. I want the church family to know that today is Brother Joel's last day serving in the capacity for which he has served this church. And I want you all to know that this brother has worked tirelessly to bring us to where we are now. We were able to broadcast all around the world. Amen. Because of his work. And I just want you to know I'm deeply appreciative for all that you've done. We are much better off today because of what you've brought to this church. And we wish you Godspeed in whatever the Lord blesses you to do as you go forward. God bless you. Thank you so much.
It's offering time, Little Grove. I said it's offering time, Little Grove. I want our visitors to know that at Little Grove, we're living with a faith that honors Jesus Christ. Every Sunday, we sow seeds into God, hoping to reap the harvest. So, if you're ready to take part in offering, go ahead and stand on your feet. Those who believe say, I have because I give, and I give because I have. I decree and declare that in the name of Jesus, that I would never be broke another day in my life. I want you saying, so Walmart can hear you say, I have because I give. And I give because I have. I decree and declare that in the name of Jesus. And I want you to say your name, that Sierra will never be broke another day in my life. Amen.